Well, hi everybody. Welcome to Refuge Assembly Online. I'm Pastor Dennis, and you're about to meet my wife, Bobby. She's our worship leader. It's Sunday, June 7th, 2020, and we pastor a great church in Soddy Daisy, Tennessee. It's a beautiful place called Refuge Assembly. And we're so happy that you've joined us this morning, or whenever you join us, it could be afternoon, because we're still online. But not for long, because we're going to be opening up the church, reopening officially on June 21st. I know I said June 7th before, but there were still too many coronavirus cases. We wanted to wait till it goes down. So that's what we decided to do. So we are officially reopening our doors on June 21st. Matter of fact, I believe that is Father's Day. That'll be a great Father's Day gift. And let's go on. We have... We've been doing these services online ever since we had to close our doors for the coronavirus to be in agreement with the way everybody is doing things. That's okay, because we've had more people now following us online on our services that are all asking, when are we going to open the doors, because they want to join us. So God works all things together for good to those who love Him and are called according to His purpose. So He has purpose in this. So we just go with the flow with His purpose. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. I'm already preaching. I'm so excited about this message. Now you can pick up our services at Facebook Live on 5 o'clock p.m. Eastern Standard Time every Sunday, or on our website anytime on our Listen to a Service page. You go to our website, which is refugeagtn.com. That's Refuge, A-G, for Assembly of God, T-N for Tennessee.com. And then go to the Listen to a Service page. It's always, the latest message is always the one at the top of the list. And now, let's worship the Lord together.
Take me in with your arms spread wide.
I hope you enjoyed the worship. I love that song, Waymaker. That's a beautiful song. We're going to be talking today. You know, there are so many wonderful places to read in the Bible. Sometimes it's the hardest thing. Once you get to know the Lord and know His Word, when you open up the Bible, it's like being a kid in a candy store. Before you open up your Bible any day, always pray, Lord, where would you have me to read today? Unless you're on a reading plan, then go with that. And I believe the Lord would have set that up for you. But pray every time before you open the Bible. Show me, Lord, what I lack, what I need to know. Speak to me through your word. And that's what I'm praying right now. Father, speak to us through your word, through your Logos word, the written word, and also through your Rhema word, the Spirit of God moving upon us. Speak to us. Teach us what we need to know, especially in this day that we're living in. We thank you for this. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. A few days back, maybe about 5 days ago, I like to pray the Psalms. We've done a number of them. But this Psalm 46, because I asked the Lord in prayer, I said, Lord, give me something for this message that you want the people to know that's very current. If you want to know the most current thing out there, read the Bible. No, I'm serious. Read it. Because there's prophecy in the scriptures. Prophecy is history written in advance. I got that from Bill Johnson. Very big fan of Bill Johnson. Love his word. He's a great student, a great theologian of the Bible. Here we go. So, Psalm 46. Can you say this? Confidence in God. Say it with me. Confidence in God. That's what this is about. So, what I'm going to do is, I'm going to just do a read through. There's only 11 verses. I'm going to do a read through out of the King James, and then we're going to take it apart. We're going to learn how to apply this to today. This is so current, I can't even begin to tell you. You'll see when we take it apart. So right now, I'm just reading through Psalm 46 out of the King James Version. This is King David speaking. King David moved in and out of the prophetic. And that's all I'm going to say. Let me get right into the scripture itself. Verse 1. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Before I go on, that is the scripture for this church, Refuge Assembly. That is actually our scripture. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. I won't put my 2 cents in anymore. Let me get the read-through first. Therefore will not we fear, we will not fear, though the earth be removed and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though the waters thereof roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with the swelling thereof, Selah. Verse 4. There is a river, the streams whereof shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacles of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God shall help her, and that right early. Verse 6. The heathen raged, the kingdoms were moved. He uttered his voice, the earth melted. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge, Selah. Come, behold the works of the Lord, what desolations he has made in the earth. He maketh wars to cease unto the end of the earth. He breaks the bow, cuts the spear in sunder. He burneth the chariot in the fire. Verse 10, be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the heathen. I will be exalted in the earth. Verse 11. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Selah. So that is a read-through of Psalm 46 out of the King James. Now, we're going to take it apart. We have some notes, some different translations, and some very current applications for us right now. Could you say right now with me? Yes. This is very current, the applications. We're going to read. We're going to study in this. We're going to be able to take what we learn today and apply it to our lives. That's going to give us confidence. Could you say that word with me? Confidence. Confidence is big faith. Confidence. Well, you're confident of something. For instance, one of the guys in the church, Jimmy, was here a little while ago. We were working on some things, and his little boy was he just learned how to ride a two-wheeler about a week ago. And I said, "Oh, you're doing so good on that bicycle." I said, "How many years have you been riding?" He only learned a week ago. I said, 5 years? I don't think he's even 10 years old. I said, 10 years? He said, 20 million years I've been riding. So I said, okay. He's confident. He knows what he's doing. He was really doing quite well. Can you say confidence? This psalm is about confidence in God. Now, a couple of notes. Verses 1 and 7 and 11 are very similar. Verse 7 and verse 11 are exactly the same. When you're studying the Bible, usually when you have an exact duplicate of a verse, it means to pay close attention to that verse. It means it's an important one. We'll go on from there. Let me read verse 1 out of the Contemporary English Version, okay? Now, let me tell you about this whole psalm. The notes say it's a special song for the people of Korah, they were the worship leaders, and for the music leader. This was written, not just written as words to read, but as a song. David probably knew songs are much easier to memorize than sermons. Sermons are great, but you could remember a song, so if the song itself has a sermon, has a message in the song, that way you could remember the message by remembering the song. David knew this, thus Psalms. Okay? So verses 7 and 11 are exactly the same. So Psalm 46, starting in verse 1, Contemporary English Version. God is our mighty fortress, always ready to help in times of trouble. I'm going to say that, always ready to help in times of trouble. He's a right now God. If you remember anything that I said this day, remember that. He's a right now God. Most people have faith to believe that he's a God that you can read in the Bible. He's done so many incredible things in the past. Most people believe that. And most people have a strong belief in what they're going to experience in heaven in the future. The part where they have trouble with, a lot of people, is they don't believe he's a God of the right now. Most people believe, well, he's not concerned with just this little thing. No, he is a right now God. He's proved that so many times over and over to Bobby and I. And in this church, in our lives, he's a right now God. In the King James, he's a very present help in the time of need. Let me go on. I'm going to read the same verse, Psalm 46, verse 1 out of the Amplified. Really, God is our refuge and strength, mighty and impenetrable to temptation, a very present and well-proved help in trouble. Isn't that good? One more version. This is out of the Message translation. They call it actually a paraphrase. Whatever, I think it's really good. God is a safe place to hide, ready to help when we need him. He's a right now God. Did you know, this is sort of the subject just a little bit, every time we talk about the Lord, every time we think of him, read his word, talk about him together, do you know our names are being written in a book of remembrance? Yeah, it's true. You can read that if you want. Malachi 3:16, a book of remembrance is being written. Every time we think on his name, talk about him, preach, study, read, whatever, have our mind on him. Our names are being written in a book of remembrance. Yeah, your name's in there because you're watching this today and we're talking about the Lord. Isn't that cool? Let's go on. Now we're going to go to Psalm 46. This will move a little quicker now, but Psalm 46, verses 2 and 3. I'll read this out of the God's Word translation. That is why we are not afraid even when the earthquakes or the mountains topple into the depths of the sea. Well, Dennis, that must be figurative that David is saying that. No, let me read you some current. And as I read this, got this information, the latest information from yesterday and today. Ready? It's based on this. When the earthquakes or the mountains topple into the depths of the sea. Psalm 46, verse 2 and 3. The significant earthquakes of the past 30 days. Indonesia. Past 30 days. 6.4 magnitude earthquake. 5.5 in Cirilus Valley, California, just a few days ago. A 6.8 earthquake in Chile. 6.5 in Nevada. Yeah, Nevada. 6.6 magnitude in the Solomon Islands. 4.5 in Ocotillo Wells, California. 6.8 magnitude earthquake in Indonesia. Now that's the large earthquakes of the past 30 days. Let me read you this. In the past 30 days in the U.S. only, magnitude 2.5 on the Richter scale or above. In the past 30 days in the United States only, there have been 2,749 earthquakes above 2.5 in the magnitude. That's huge. Isn't that what Jesus said in Matthew 24 and other places? There would be earthquakes in diverse places. There are more earthquakes on the earth taking place right now than ever in the history of the earth. How do you like that one? And what about the mountains toppled into the midst of the sea? You just read that out of verse 2. I did, didn't I? Thursday, a massive landslide dragged 8 buildings into Norway's sea as a huge chunk of the coast vanished underwater. I would say that that's exactly what that scripture talk about. The mountains topple into the midst of the sea. That happened on Thursday. It happened. Let me go on. We have a good friend of ours, a cruise director we've worked with for many years. We've been friends with her. I remember her telling us a story that her and a friend were on their way back from hiking Mount St. Helens when the mountain blew. The whole side of Mount St. Helens exploded. The whole side of the mountain exploded, come toward them. All of a sudden, they hear this great noise. The earth rumbled, and they were already a few miles away. And all of a sudden, they said, drive faster. Drive a lot faster, because the explosion, all the dust and everything is coming toward them. They both ended up in the hospital because there was so much dust in their lungs, but they survived. But if you look at on the internet or YouTube or whatever about the explosion of Mount St. Helens, the whole side of the mountain came loose. Dennis, what does that mean? Well, they're watching it again. Mount St. Helens and a few other mountains in that area. They're volcanic mountains. Wow. That sounds exactly like verse 2 and 3 out of the Bible. Verse 3, the waters roar, the seas foam, the mountains shake, and the surging of the waves, Selah. The word Selah is a great word. It means pause and think of that. Isn't that a great word, Selah? Pause and think of this. Pause and think of that. Bobby and I worked at sea for many years, maybe around 25 years or so, give or take, on cruise ships. We know what it's like to be in rough waters and rough seas. When the third story above the waterline looks like a washing machine in your porthole, a little scary. We've seen the waves roaring. Sometimes when we're on the coast, like on the rocks, and the waves hit the coast, it rumbles the rocks. You can feel the rocks shake. Yeah, it's real. That 6.8, the 6.8 quake in Indonesia I talked about just a few minutes ago, this is just recently this happened, caused a 10-foot tsunami. Let me explain the difference between a wave and a tsunami. A 10-foot wave, maybe from the ground to about here, is not that big, a 10-foot wave. But a 10-foot tsunami is huge, because a tsunami is not a wave that goes like this. A tsunami could be a mile or two long, and when that 10-foot of water comes, it just keeps on going. Remember the tsunamis in Japan a few years back? A tsunami is a big and bad thing. The wind and the waves are roaring. It's part of the times we live in. I guess this is very current. Psalm 46. Shall we go on? We go on to verse 4. Matter of fact, 4 and 5. There is a river, the streams whereof shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacles of the Most High. Dennis, that doesn't sound like Jerusalem to me. There's no river in there. We're going to keep reading. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God shall help her, and that right early. This is a prophetic verse. There is a river, the streams whereof shall make glad the city of God. This is a prophetic verse. Let me read you some notes from Dake's Bible. Dake's was a Bible scholar, passed away a number of years ago. We have one of his Bibles. He's incredible. He spent 30 years of his life studying the Bible, writing down all his notes, going back and forth, comparing scriptures. Beautiful. So let me read you what he wrote. This is no doubt the river that will flow out from the sanctuary, the temple, the capital building of Christ when he comes to reign, as the millennial reign. It will flow southward from the temple through Jerusalem and then be parted into two streams. Half of the river will flow into the Mediterranean Sea and half to the Dead Sea. Well, the waters of the Dead Sea will then be healed and fish will come out from the Mediterranean to the Dead Sea, exceedingly many. I just read you two different prophetic scriptures from Ezekiel 47 and Zechariah 14. You can look these up if you want. This could also refer to the river flowing out from the Capitol building of God in the New Jerusalem when it is moved to earth. If you want to read about that, it's Revelation 22. Revelation chapter 22. This is prophetic for a future fulfillment. It hasn't been fulfilled yet, but it's a prophecy for the future. There's no such river in Jerusalem right now, but there will be. There will be one when the Messiah comes for his 1,000-year millennial reign. Whew. I want to see that. I want to be there for that, if possible. Let's go on. Psalm 46, starting in verse 6. Nations rage, kingdoms fall, but at the voice of God, the earth itself melts. In the King James, the heathen rage. The heathen rage. The heathen, the unbelievers, the barbarians, people doing crazy things. Sounds like Antifa to me. How about you? I'll get mail and something about that. Doesn't matter. Truth is truth. Okay? The heathen rage. The earth melts. Kingdoms fall. I remember when the Berlin Wall fell. Do you remember that? When the Berlin Wall fell. Do you know that over the past, even 50 years, borders have changed. Even names of land, names of kingdoms have changed over the past 100 years or so. Iran used to be Persia. Iraq was Babylon. That's why boundaries are so important to God. Boundaries. The globalists want there to be one world, a new world order, one king or emperor overall. Sounds like the Antichrist today. They don't want borders. World without borders, that's one of their things. That's not how God feels about it. That's why he told the Jews many times, don't remove the ancient landmark. It's important. Boundaries are important. Some of you were thinking about, well, what about the wall Donald Trump is making? It's important. Boundaries are important to God. Okay? Shall we go on? Let's go to verse 7. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Reading out of the Amplified. Our fortress and high tower, Selah. Pause and calmly think about that. The Lord of hosts, the God of angel armies, is that. The Lord of hosts hosts many angel armies. Could you imagine there's armies of angels? And they care about us. These are not fallen angels. These are the angels of heaven. Wow. Let's go on. Same verse, verse 7. Matter of fact, I'll go 7, 8, 9 out of the Contemporary English Version. The Lord all-powerful is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Verse 8, come, see the fearsome things the Lord has done on earth. Verse 9, God brings wars to an end all over the world. He breaks the arrows, shatters the spears, and burns the shields. Hallelujah. Can a nation be born in a day? Going back to 1948. And going back to Isaiah 66, verse 8. In 1948, the nation of Israel was born. Isaiah prophesied about it. Many looked for it. Centuries they waited for it. And it happened in our generation. The nation of Israel was born. The next day, they were surrounded by an army of multiple nations ready to destroy them. But God and his angel armies. If you ever get the chance to see the series Against All Odds, we have it here at our church. We've shown bits and pieces of it. What the nation of Israel has gone through is proof there are angel armies. It is proof that the land of Israel belongs to them. It is proof that God is on their side. And thank you, Lord Jesus, we as Christians are grafted in. Can you say thank you, Lord Jesus? Wow. My favorite part of this entire message is coming up right now. Take a break, move around. And then listen close. This part can change your life and can change your world. Yeah, I'm that serious. Is that real? If you apply it. See, if you can't apply it, it can't help you. One more time. If you can't apply this, it can't help you. But you can apply this. Psalm 46, verse 10. The Lord speaking. Be still and know that I am God. The Lord speaking. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. Let me read you out of the Message Bible, then I'll come back and we'll talk to you about this in a minute. Step out of the traffic. Take a long, loving look at me. Your high God, above politics, above everything. Back in the New King James, be still and know that I am God. Let me paraphrase and read some things from 1 Kings 19. Remember Elijah the prophet? He was having trouble with Jezebel and King Ahab and all that whole lot back then. And when he was threatened, he ran. He finally ended up in a cave. And the Lord spoke to him. What are you doing here? He said, I've been jealous for you. They killed all the rest of the prophets. Only I'm left, and I'm still preaching your word. I'm scared. The Lord asked him this a number of times. Finally, the Lord said, come out to the entrance of this cave. It was located in a cliff between, it's a big valley cliff, that he was in this cave. And the Lord went by for Elijah to see him. First, Elijah saw a strong wind. the wind was so strong that it was breaking the rocks on the side of the cliff. Elijah said, well, yeah, but the Lord wasn't in there, just the wind. Then an earthquake happened. Then a huge fire, flames. And then a still, small voice. He covered his face. A still, small voice. This verse says, be still and know that I am God. May I suggest to you, if you want to hear that still and small voice, you've got to take time to be still before the Lord. He can speak to you anywhere, in the car, at the store, anywhere. But if you want to get intimate with God and hear that still and small voice, so you know that you know that you know what you're hearing is the voice of God, you must take time to be still with Him. That is the most important thing I can tell you. I've proven it. Shut the TV off. Turn the music off. And just be alone with God. Have the Bible with you. Many times He'll speak to you through the pages of His Word. Sometimes He'll give you a rhema word, a knowing. The still, small voice. Yes, you can hear the voice of God. Yes, He wants to talk to you. And He wants you to talk to Him. That's why it's a relationship. It's a personal relationship between you and God. This is not religion I'm talking about. This is relationship. There's a huge difference. Okay? Be still and know that I am God. That's the Lord speaking, saying this to you. You want to hear the still small voice? Take time to be still. Before we close, I want to tell you about some of the benefits of taking time and being still, being alone with God. It was about 2 years ago for me, maybe 2.5 years ago. I was praying a particular part of Psalm 119. I love to pray the Psalms. I was praying some particular verses out of that. There's a particular place I like to sit on the couch in the morning. I get up before Bobby. She prays at night. I pray in the morning. I get up and I sit on the couch. I have my coffee. Some of you might be saying, oh, Pastor drinks coffee. Yep. Yeah, I love coffee. I enjoy it a lot. So now you know. I sat on the couch. I was studying Psalm 119. And I started praying some of the verses in there. I said, Lord, teach me your statutes. Teach me your precepts. Give me wisdom. Let not any iniquity have dominion over me, that I will not be ashamed of anything in my life, but my life will be well pleasing to you in every way. And I felt in my spirit, pray it again. Okay, same prayer. Teach me your statutes, teach me your precepts, give me wisdom, let not any iniquity. Pray it again. And I started to pray it again. As I was praying, I left the couch. I was still sitting there. But what I saw in front of me, I don't remember if my eyes were open or closed, but the whole scene in front of me changed. I was in looked like a huge marble courtroom. Fog, it was just fog, and it was a huge white throne in front of me, and I knew that who I was looking at on the throne was Heavenly Father. Could see His face. Just knew He was there. And I'm like, what is this? And then I heard these voices come from the throne. And what shall I do for this young man? And I turned to my left, and there was Jesus right next to me, right here. He said, what do I say? And he looked at me with compassion. He said, say what you've been praying on the couch. Go ahead and just say it. And I did. I said, Father, teach me your statutes. Teach me your precepts. Give me wisdom. Let not any iniquity have dominion over me. That I will not be ashamed of anything in my life, but my life will be well pleasing to you in every way. And then I saw Heavenly Father look this way on the throne, say to somebody next to him, couldn't see the face, send opportunities. I know how long ago this was. It seems like just a couple of years. This was four and a half years ago. Send opportunities. That was November 2016, November. Send opportunities. I was like, wow. Bang. I'm back on the couch. What just happened? I looked to my left. The Lord Jesus still there with me. Is there anything else? He asked. I was like, yes. The same for Bobby. See, that was November, December, January, February. February, we got the opportunity to pastor this church. It's been 4.5 years we've been here. Ask the Lord to send you an opportunity if you need an opportunity. Spend time with the Lord so you can hear this still small voice. Many people have had miracles like this happen to them. I'm not the only one. I will never forget it. It changed our lives. I'm here to tell you about it. It's worth spending time with God. Okay? I can't close a service without taking an invitation. There might be somebody watching this service who doesn't know Jesus, or maybe you knew him one time and you walked away. Would you like to know him again? Would you like to know him for the first time and get that relationship with him to experience things like I just told you? It is so well worth it. If you could say yes to that, then pray with me. Just repeat after me. We've led many, many people in this prayer. You may have said this prayer hundreds of times, but today may be your day. Either to come to him for the first time as your personal Lord and Savior, or to rededicate your life to him. Whatever it is, repeat after me, and let's come to Jesus. Lord Jesus, I want a personal relationship with you. I want to hear your still small voice. I want to learn of you. Learn your ways. I want you to teach me your precepts. Teach me your statutes. Give me wisdom. Let not any iniquity have dominion over me, so I'm not ashamed of anything in my life, but my life will be well-pleasing to you in every way. Please forgive me, Lord, for anything that I've ever thought or said or imagined or done that disappointed you in me. Please forgive me. Today, Lord Jesus, come into my heart. Today, right now, I make you my Lord and Savior. I am yours forever. I am born again right now because you are a right now God. Thank you for accepting me into the beloved. Thank you for receiving me because I receive you. Today is the start of a new life with God. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. If that is you, that you're watching me now, welcome. You're on an incredible journey. With that said, once again, folks, we're going to be reopening the building here in Soddy Daisy, Tennessee on June 21st. That's 2 weeks from now. If you could join us in person, we'd love to have you. But if you want to continue to join us online, guess what? We're going to continue filming and putting the services online. But that's all for this week. Lord willing, we'll see you again next week. And please be praying for us on the 21st. Don't forget to log on to Refuge Assembly by logging on to refugeagtn.com. There's a lot of great information on our website. There's even our email on there. Even my phone number is on there. You need to talk, give a call. I don't know how long we'll be able to leave my personal phone number on there, but it's on there right now. You need to talk, give a call. But until next week, we love you. God loves you even more. Be safe. Bye-bye.